نحمد ونصلي على رسوله الكريم اما بعد فاعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي my respected elders and my dear sisters and brothers السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته may peace mercy and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be on all of you. I relate to you one of the earliest of tragic events to have unfolded on earth as it relates to two sons of Prophet Adam alayhi salam, the very first human being to tread the earth. This is the story of Qabil and Habil. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Ma'idah, and recite to them the story of Adam's two sons. In truth, when they both offered a sacrifice to Allah and it was accepted from one of them but was not accepted from the other. Having realized that his sacrifice was rejected whilst that of his younger brother Habil was accepted, how did he react? You'd think that he would repent, reassess his relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or re-evaluate his iman in order to attempt to pinpoint what went wrong. But his reaction was starkly different. He said, I will kill you. The former said, indeed, Allah only accepts from the people of taqwa. In other words, why not focus on the source of your problem that caused your sacrifice to be rejected, that is your lack of taqwa, instead of focusing on eliminating my existence. Habil continues addressing the older brother, if you should raise your hand against me to kill me, I shall not raise my hand against you to kill you. Indeed, I fear Allah, Lord of the worlds. Indeed, I want you to obtain my sin and your sin, so you will be among the companions of the fire, and that is the recompense of the wrongdoers. As time passed, the idea of murdering brother grew more and more fair seeming, and his soul encouraged him to murder his brother. There is one statement from this story that I would like to point out, one that you read seconds ago, but perhaps did not give it the full attention it deserves. Despite it being an expression that kept our predecessor up at night and haunted them by day, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only accepts from the people of taqwa. Yes, carrying out a good deed is a blessing, but it is one that cannot be considered complete until it is coupled with another blessing, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's acceptance. For the wakeful Muslims, this is a cause of concern. Meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with few good deeds is a calamity, but worse is meeting him with many good deeds which crumble away before your very eyes, and years upon years of supposed hard work is turned down by him. How could this happen? Allah only accepts from the people of taqwa. Let us consider how our predecessor reacted to this ayah. Ali bin Abi Talib radiallahu anhu said, be more concerned with Allah's acceptance of a good deed than with the doing of the good deed itself. Have you not heard Allah saying, Allah only accepts from the people of taqwa? Abdul Aziz bin Abi Rawad radiallahu anhu said, speaking about the approach of our predecessor to good deeds, I witnessed a people who would make great efforts in attaining knowledge, and when they would finally attain it, they would be struck with grief, not knowing whether Allah will accept from them or not. A beggar once asked the companion Abdullah bin Umar radiallahu anhu for money, to which Abdullah said to his son, give me a dinar. When the beggar walked away, his son said to his father, May Allah accept from you, O Father. Abdullah responded, If I knew that Allah has accepted from me a single prostration or a single dirham in charity, there would not be any visitor whom I would love to meet more than death. Do you know who Allah accepts from? Allah only accepts from the people of taqwa. Their consciousness of this concept was so intense that some of them would be seen weeping during their dying moments, fearing the implications of this ayah. Amir bin Abdullah bin Al-Zubair radiallahu anhu was seen crying profusely during his last illness. He was asked, What makes you cry? He responded with an ayah from the Quran. Allah only accepts from the people of taqwa. With that said, the key question must be asked, Are there signs for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's acceptance? Which are, in turn, signs that our hearts are working towards a path of taqwa. What is the use in filling a bucket if it has holes within it? And what is the use of writing an exam if you had been revising for the wrong paper? And what is the use of climbing a ladder if it was leaning on the wrong wall? Furthermore, we may ask, What use is there in the doing of a good deed if it is eventually turned down by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So, most of us are probably thinking right now, how do I know if my Ramadan was accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Now, there is not a 100% guaranteed way to tell exactly how much of our worship was accepted, but there is a pretty good indicator that can help you find out, and that is steadfastness, taqwa. In other words, if we are able to continue the good actions we picked up in Ramadan well after this month, that would be a major sign that our deeds were accepted. What I mean is, once we have achieved forgiveness in Ramadan by fasting and standing in salah, what we should do post Ramadan, what we should do after Ramadan. One of the signs of accepted season of fasting and standing in salah, one of the signs of accepted Ramadan is that our life changes, even if were to mean or if was to mean just by few inches, but the life has changed. If my life changes after Ramadan, it means my Ramadan was correct. If my life become better after Ramadan, it means my Ramadan was correct. But if my life goes back to way it was before Ramadan, then I wasted my Ramadan.